The second phase of Darlington South Park restoration project began today when Councillor Lee Vasey switched on the pump to drain the park's main lake.
Very, very excited. I think it's wonderful. I think for us to have something at the end of a project that's going to be state-of-the-art, beautiful and loved and valued by everybody will be something worth waiting for. The wildlife in the lake will be well looked after. They'll be moved to a safer place and brought back in when it's all cleaned and restored. And we hope that the new lake will bring a habitat for all kinds of wildlife who'll settle there of their own accord. A few surprises in the lake that might interest people, like possibly a diamond ring or even the plough might appear. And if that does, what a find for Darlington. The community is very buoyant because we've got at least 80 people on our Friends of South Park, and these people are going to be involved in the decisions of what we have here, how we look at different ways of funding things, and how we even look at the way the trees appear, or the grass appears, or the flowers appear. So they're going to be well involved in everything to do with the park. But we do know that somebody's in a peak of temper have thrown their wedding ring in there, so there's a definite wedding ring. So Lord of the Rings.
I wonder if there's anything happening in South Park today. No, nothing happening in South Park today.
The weather was as glorious as the occasion, when children from Skern Park Infants, dressed in Victorian splendour, came to the official opening of South Park's magnificent new gates.
We're from just outside Gisborough, Lingdale. We have four horses that we use for driving. We do the horse-drawn carriages for weddings, mainly during the summer months, but in the winter time, like this, like opening gates for parks or anything, really.
They look really fantastic.
I like the gates. I think they're really, really nice.
Fantastic. Really, really good.
They look beautiful. Absolutely fantastic.
Very period.
Work on the restoration project at South Park has been ongoing now for more than 4 months. All toilet blocks have been pulled down. The seating area overlooking the bandstand has been pulled out. The railings have been renewed and painted. And the lake has been drained. Keith Bulmer is the site agent for Helens on the South Park project. He can give us an update on two of the areas being restored, beginning at the lake.
We've completed the desilting works in the lake, and now, as works progress, we're in the process of putting foundations in for the retaining walls in three different locations around the lake edge. We've come across a slight problem in as much as ground conditions aren't adequate to take the weight of the wall. So what we're having to do is excavate down below formation and backfill the excavation with a rock armour stone, which will have sufficient load-bearing capacity for the wall that's going to be built above it. Down by the rockery now, you can see the remains of the old bridge over one of the ornamental ponds. Quite a bit of extensive shrub and tree clearing has gone on here. Plans for this area, where there's a new bridge going to be commissioned, and the area, the embankment behind us, there's going to be large boulders imported and strategically placed, and then the whole area is going to be extensively planted up.
A lot of work has been done, but there's still a lot more to do to restore South Park back to its former glory.
I'm Jim Fleming, a director of Heritage Engineering. We got involved in the restoration at South Park because of our expertise in the restoration of Victorian cast iron. Our first day was to remove the bandstand, tagged all the items that had been removed, compared them with the catalogues. We got patterns made for any bits that were missing. We then had the castings made. We have now reached the stage where we're assembling the roof. We will shortly be erecting the bandstand at South Park.
We did have exceptional winds. They were probably the strongest Darlington's experienced in years.
Lots of the high winds on Friday and Saturday night. Quite a few of the trees have come down in the bar, and we've got a problem here. in the sense that this tree is about to come up by the roots and the next big gust of wind is going to take it over. So we're going to try and fell it before that happens and we've cordoned off the area. We've lost quite a few trees in the park, which is a shame.
However, within the restoration project, we are planting over 1,000 trees. These trees will be planted in various locations, such as the Rose Garden, the Rockery, and alongside the bowling greens. Over 500 saplings have already been planted by the Friends of South Park on the south side. And Helen's workmen are continuing to plant on the north side. So that whatever the weather brings, South Park will continue to have a fabulous variety of trees. The magnificent restoration of South Park has been a massive undertaking. But what happens once it's complete? To help overcome this challenge, a Friends of South Park has been established.
It's a good idea because it gives us ownership back again of the park.
It is a particularly beautiful park, and if we can restore it back to its original splendour, or even better, then I think it's a very worthwhile project.
Didn't know, was interested to know what they were going to do in the park and how they were going to make it more user-friendly for everybody, families in particular.
It's not just the park that the council owns, it's our park again, which is the way it should be. Everybody should be using it.
The kids' play area has been fantastic. We've been up lots of times since it opened. Kids absolutely love it. Brilliant facility.
When the restoration is finished, we hope that we will get involved with gardening projects like we are now, are doing today, managing some of the facilities, raising funds, improving people's information about the park, and continually doing projects to improve the facilities in the park.
Have a day in a few weeks' time where we're going to have a presence in the park. Friends are going to be out talking to users of the park and encouraging them to join up and see how they can help.
The Friends of South Park are going to become a sort of key part of the running of the park in the future. It's not just about involving the community and generating ownership, but it's about finding parts of the park that maybe need work doing on them and sort of getting volunteers involved. I mean, you can see behind me a good group of friends who have been involved today, planting out free beds, doing fantastic work and taking great pride in what they're doing. And in the future, we want more and more people from the community involved like that, because it's a people's park. It's a park, in a sense, that belongs in the community. And we want the community as involved as we can in the future running of it.
There's a lot going on at the park at the minute. I would really like to see it finished so people can come back and enjoy it again.
So, this is the William Potts Memorial Clock, which means we need a potted history of William Potts. And he was born in Salt Yard, which is just off Bond Gate, in 1809. And in 1830, he became an apprentice to a clockmaker on High Row called Samuel Thompson. Now, Samuel was pioneering a new form of clock, the turret clock, a big, tall clock. And so in 1833, when William Potts finished his apprenticeship and went to Leeds to open himself, set himself up in business away from his master, he too decided to specialise in turret clocks. Now, this was a fantastic time to be into turret clocks, because the Industrial Revolution was in full spring and all these new industrial communities were springing up. And every industrial community needed a church as its focal point. And on every church, then it was a spire, and every spire needed a turret clock. And then every one of these new industrial communities had factories. And every factory needed a big turret clock over the entranceway to make sure all the workers clocked in on time. And then all of these new industrial communities were joined together by new railways. Every station on the railway needed at least two turret clocks. One big and imposing above the entrance to make sure all the townspeople got to the station to catch their trains on time, and another hanging above the platform to make sure that the trains actually did leave on time. And so it was a great time to be into building turret clocks. And William Potts, the Darlington chap, became the official clockmaker to railway companies across the whole of the north of England, and he became the unofficial clockmaker to churches around the globe, from Buenos Aires in Argentina to places closer to home like Aldbrisson, John, Northallerton, Sedgefield, Crook, Winterton, Scarborough, Sunderland, Skelton, and of course here in Darlington. In 1864 he put the clock in the town clock in the market square, put the clock in St Cuthbert's Church spire, and in 1885 he put two clocks in the new station that was being built at Banktop. And those were probably among the last clocks that he saw off his production line in Leeds, because the following year, 1886, he took a tumble down some stairs in his workshop, and he gashed his head, he broke his leg, bronchitis set in, and the following year, 1887, he died aged 77. But although he'd been away from Darlington for about 50 years, he'd always been very fondly looking back to the town, and was always very keen for news from home. And so when his sons heard that the committee that ran South Park was coming under pressure to build a clock in the park, they'd promised to build a clock 50 years earlier, the sons from Leeds offered to put one in memorial to their father. At first they offered a chiming clock, but that was turned down, and eventually it was agreed that a non-chiming clock should be put in the observation tower that was raised 10 feet here at Park Lodge. And it was set in action on the 4th of September amid a great ceremony. Sir Joseph Whitwell Pease did the honours. He was one of Darlington's leading townsmen. A large cord was thrown down from the clock, and Sir Joseph took hold of it, and he gave a long pull, a strong pull, a pull all together, bang, and started the clock. It was precisely 3 o'clock, and he stood here and began his speech of honour to all the assembled multitude, and then, drifting on the breeze, came a bong, bong, bong. It was another Potts clock. It was the town clock, and it had decided that in the town centre it was 3 o'clock over there, precisely. Well, precisely-ish, anyway.
Thanks to some fantastic and painstaking work, the newly restored bandstand here at South Park is already looking absolutely fantastic.
Today we're here to do some of the snagging works.
Snagging involves looking at every bit of detail that you've got within the bandstand.
Identifying anything that might be slightly incorrect or slightly misaligned.
From the balustrading at the side, the columns, the fretwork at the top, the paintwork on the soffits, and making sure everything is as it should be.
The clerk of works actually found a golden ball missing, which surprised us all. Now, we paint the cast iron 4 times, 4 different coats, and we didn't pick it up. So I was quite impressed he found that, but it's now been replaced and it's looking good as new. I've just been talking to Andy Wimble from the Heritage Lottery Fund about some of the civil works on the stairs. We're unsure what to do with the brickwork because it's slightly damaged. What we've decided to do is sheet it with galvanised sheets and then paint it green, so it's actually in keeping with Branson.
Already there's a queue of bands, I gather, waiting to perform there, and that's partly what the whole thing's about, is actually getting more use into the park and bringing people in and making it a safer, more pleasant place to be, and that bandstand is symbolic and functional in those terms. And the best views from that bandstand I've come across, really. Excellent.
I'm very happy with everything. The sun is shining.
The bandstand's looking gorgeous.
On July the 4th, 1893, hundreds of people in this area sat here and listened to new bands launching the new bandstand here at South Park. 110 years on, it'll once again be a superb venue for bands, for drama and for all sorts of events.
I'm part of a team of four gardeners which maintain the park in general. We're actually rebuilding an old trellis which was provided for a screen for the bowlers. It was made of old rustic fencing and generally got dilapidated over the years. As part of the restoration project, we're trying to revamp it and build it in a new style.
The trellising was designed by Steve Robson, the other gardener.
I designed it. It's based slightly on a sort of Japanese-Chinese effect. A lot of Victorian parks had at the time. There's nothing actually existing in the park at the moment in this style, so we thought we'd have a go at this.
We normally do around the park is grass cutting, planting flowers, cutting back shrubs, picking litter up as the main job first thing on the morning.
In keeping with the new start for the park, we've chosen varieties with names that are relevant to that. And we've got two varieties of roses going in called New Dawn and Breath of Life, and which will be planted next to Camellias, which is Tomorrow's Dawn, and French Lavender underneath.
A lot of hard work involved, but still, it's got to be done. It'll look excellent when it's finished.
I'm very pleased with the way the job's turned out. It's something we don't normally do, and touch wood, so far we're doing a good job.
We're trying to keep as many of the original features as possible. Yes, I know we've repaired a lot, but the main structure has been kept since 1908. Brian and Dave, father and son team, and actually they're working very well together.
We're restoring the park to its original state. This is the third project that we've been working on. We've had to take the old timbers out, which were rotten and stuff, which amounted to 60% nearly of the building. Now we're at the stage where we're starting to pull it back.
Quite an interesting job if the truth was known. It's not the sort of normal joinery job where we have to just work off a normal drone. Dave and Brian are having to restore this cafe back to its original beauty, and they're working with logs and hardwood, which every day is a different tale and a different story.
A challenge if I do see it, so. We get guidelines or photographs and stuff.
I used to come here years ago in my teenage days. It was a very popular meeting place for all the teenagers. It was nice, it was a lovely place. It was popular, it was always crowded. Nice, happy atmosphere. It should be lovely in the future. I'll certainly bring my grandchildren back down when they come.
These two are the splices for the main trusses that the joiners had to repair. It was a very technical job, and as you can see, they've spliced them really well. Once they are painted and coated, the joints will never be seen. And this one here, where the bolts go right up into the truss, back down into the joints. As you can see, once they are coated up and painted, never be noticed.
I don't know what he's doing, he doesn't know himself.